Down Under BJJ Radio is live. 1 hour of arm snapping, mat tapping, leg cracking Brazilian Jiu-jitsu news, reviews, and submissions for you with your hosts Dan and Rat. As always, we are sponsored by the Fight Factory, so put down that candy and cake and enjoy the show.
Yeah, just order some pizza. Yeah, I'll be ready in a bit.
Oh, right. Hey, how's it going there, guys? It's the Down Under BJJ Radio Show. I'm your host, Daniel, and Murat will be joining us shortly. All right, today we're going to cover the BOA Super 8 event, and we've got Thiago Stefanuti on. He's the matchmaker for the event. We had Sai, the promoter, and the 8-man tournament winner, Bruno Alves. All right, guys, so tune in, and I hope you guys enjoy. But before we get into it, don't forget to check out thefightfactory.com.au. Those guys have got all the best gis and MMA gear, jiu-jitsu gear, lifestyle gear, everything you need. So check those guys out because they have done a great job of supporting the BOA event. All right, guys, we just had BOA Super 8. So we're just going to have a chat to Thiago Stefanuti, who was the matchmaker on the night, and Sai, who was the promoter of BOA and the man that got it all done. Thanks for coming on the show, guys.
Thank you very much, Dan.
And congratulations to Murat on his black belt and his big win in his first black belt fight on the BOA undercard.
Thank you. Thanks, guys.
Well done, Murat.
Thank you, coach.
You're welcome.
Before we get into the BOA, what happened at the grading? So Murat's mum was getting a bit excited.
Yeah, but she protects more his brother than him, man. Yeah.
We found out he's the favorite.
Yeah. That's a life.
So, how did you think the event ran?
It went pretty well, man. I was very happy with it overall to start with. Obviously, there's a lot of stuff in it that I want to improve. And Thiago and I have already spoken about it. But I was happy for it for a first guy. There's a bit of an adjustment to the sort of like some of the jiu-jitsu culture that's around it and the feedback and stuff afterwards. But it was really good. Really enjoyed it. The athletes were amazing to deal with, man. Like very professional, considering it's predominantly an amateur sport. They were very, very well behaved and very professional in the lead up and on the night. So I was really impressed.
Yep. Oh, that's good. Yeah. So it was a pretty big build up. How many months preparation did it take to get the event done?
I think I'd sort of had a first chat with Thiago October last year, and then obviously at the Road to Rebellion 2, and obviously we've both been very busy, so probably really been intensively doing it for the last 3-4 months. But obviously, like, Thiago had years of experience and knows what he's doing from his side, and I've had a bit of experience on my side, so it kind of came together pretty quickly, and we had so much support, so it made it pretty easy.
What do you think of the 8-man tournament? Was that the correct format to go with, do you think?
Yeah, 100%. I know you like the submission only, but definitely after the weekend sold that we've got the right format. There's obviously a debate whether or not there should be seeding or a random draw. I was really happy with it. I think the feedback so far has been good too, but I guess it comes down to what the fans like as well.
Okay, did you get feedback on the random draw, did you? I thought that was a good idea myself.
Yeah, most people were really positive. A few people sort of thought that we should have seeded the event. But I think it adds to the excitement, and it kind of helps that whole, dark horse, sort of having a dark horse in the race mentality where, you know, because of the draw, anything can happen. It makes it really exciting. So I liked it, but we'll see. We'll see what else comes out over the next few weeks. But I like the idea of the random draw and the way it was.
I like that as well, man. I think the way we did the things, Daniel and Murat, I think what we wanted, and the jiu-jitsu fighters, they normally they don't have that feeling. It's more than win the fight. It's give a good entertainment to the public. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think with the Grand Prix, it's easier to explain to the guys they need to submit and fight to give a good show to the public. And we were very blessed to have also the super fighters as well. They came on the stage and they showed up everything we were asking for. I think that's beautiful, you know, because we wanted something not boring,
yeah,
to the public, you know, and we need action because it's a different format of show, and they gave it to us exactly what we were expecting from them. That's it.
Yeah, you guys modified a couple of the rules. I think I noticed you were giving out, was it 1 point for a submission attempt?
Six minutes. Can I talk about that?
Yeah.
6 minutes rounds for all fights.
Yep.
Normally for black belt division, we have 10 minutes on IBJJF traditional rules. 8 minutes for brown belts, 7 minutes for purple, and 6 minutes for blue belts. We made everyone fight on 6 minutes rounds, and we gave 1 point for submission attempt and stand advantage. And we penalized as well the fighters for stalling the fight between 15 and 15 seconds, instead 20 seconds. I think on that way, the rules made the fights fight more offensively.
Yeah.
And the result they fought of that, I think all of you had a chance to see, and the fights, in my opinion, were just incredible.
Yeah, I think 6 minutes was a good idea because they're pretty explosive matches. I think Marco Souza was the one for me that was the most entertaining. He was just explosive.
Brilliant, wasn't it?
The whole way through, I think the crowd was getting behind him. I was watching the stream. I couldn't be there, but it seemed like everyone was getting into his fights when he was on.
Yeah, and the other thing is too, because it's an invitation-only event, I mean, I think the guys realize that if they don't fight in an exciting way, they're just not going to get invited back. So I think that's an extra motivator too. So, and everyone was just excited to go for it. And I think just for the sake of their own pride and for also showcasing their skills, they all put it out there. So the combination of the rules, the format, I think it really paid off and it was really exciting. The energy in there was amazing. Really good.
Thiago, there was, When Murat, he went for a submission, then they went off the mat and they restarted in the center from standing. And some matches, when they sort of got dragged back into the middle and went from where they were. What was the rule for that on the night? Was it to be restarted standing or was it supposed to be continued in the position?
In that case, the rules we followed exactly the same the rules IBJJF has. Okay.
Yeah.
But what we did, for example, when you fight the IBJJF tournament, the match is on the ground, and the referee can leave the fight a little bit more on the security area.
Yeah.
Actually, they didn't have to permit that. They have to come back the fight to the middle. But on the tournaments, you see that all the time. They leave a little bit more because if the guy submit, avoid all troubles or everything. But with us, after the secret area was the ground, and the ground was like 1.5 meters lower than the stage.
Yeah.
And what we did, we followed the BJJF rules. On the point of like, okay, you have the submission up on. We come back to the fight to the middle with both on the stand up, and we give 2 points.
Yeah.
In some case, for example, on some fights, you have to understand what is happening. On the every situation is different, you know.
Yeah.
And that's the interpretation of the referee. The referee is on the top. If I come now and I say to you what I think, it's not fair with the referees who were there, you know. They were there and they have their own interpretation about the situation. And you have to get one for one and ask to them what they think about the situation in this case. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But we got for sure the best referees in Melbourne, I think.
Yeah.
And one thing is important to say, Daniel.
Yeah.
I never seen one competition, one BJJ competition after the competition, nobody complains about referees. Okay.
Yeah.
And second, I never saw in my life someone who won the fight by a referee mistake came on public and say, "Look, I won by a referee mistake."
Yeah, that's true.
Did you see that before?
No.
I never seen that before. Or, especially on jiu-jitsu rules, when the rules are so interpretative, some mistakes happen, okay? And that's not for balls. We have to understand the interpretation of the referee on the moment of the situation. It's not fair if I comment about my referees because they did the best. And you have to talk, if you want, you can talk with them about the referee staff on board, and they can tell you better what happened there.
Yeah.
In the case of Murat, after the guy took him down, he had the guillotine on. And particularly, I spoke with Gustavo about that. Gustavo saw the guillotine was tight first time. That's why he gave the 2 points to Murat. And the fight come back on the stand-up, and Murat got again. And you saw the result after. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It showed the first guillotine could do the same result of the second. But it's everything about the interpretation of the referee. For you know that better, you have to interview the referee.
Yeah.
I think also, like, there's a difference between a position that's like a submission. Like, for example, my position, the guillotine, is a submission. It's not something that you sweep from, or it's not a position that you hold. I mean, it's either a submission or it's not. But, like, for example, if you have a crucifix, if you have, like, a certain other positions, they can be a submission, but they also are a holding position. So you can get dragged back in that position.
Yeah. As well.
Exactly. That's what I mean. Crucifix, I'm applied to certain positions, are actually not a submission yet, so you can get dragged back in. But with the guillotine, if we get dragged back in, and you can even ask Lucas, as soon as the ref said stop, my guillotine was on, and I could feel him trying to pull my hand out of his neck. And I was saying to Gustavo, he's pulling my hand out when I stopped.
Yeah,
so it's very difficult to restart that. Yeah, well, I didn't want to let go because I knew it was on.
Yeah. Of course,
but anyway,
of course,
yeah.
I suppose that's,
Maybe
that's the difference between like the Thai fights and the MMA fights. Like, you can really see the damage being done. There's not so much interpretation.
Yeah,
but
the judges get
that. What sport, you know?
Yeah.
What combat sport have you ever not heard people say, "I got robbed"? This happened. That happened. It's the same with even Aussie rules. Like, every week they're talking about the referees and umpires. People are very passionate about what's happening. Of course, mistakes happen sometimes, but people sort of overanalyze it at some points, and sometimes justifiably. But I think unless you feel that there's an ulterior motive behind a decision, people have to be understanding of what the referees and judges are going through. And unfortunately, most of the people who are critical of referees and judges don't ever feel the need to step up and become referees and judges and show everyone how it's done. So it's kind of really easy to criticize. And
I can go also a little bit fast. Those guys, ask how many black belts did the international referee course here in Melbourne. I guarantee for you the three referees, they were there. They did at least two international referee course each.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And a lot of guys I saw complaining they never attended one referee course, and everyone is a specialist on refereeing, you know? That's just funny.
Yeah, so
it's just funny.
Probably 90% of the people that say stuff aren't really qualified to be saying what the rules are because they haven't even read them or gone into too much detail. Yeah, I did that referees course a couple of years ago. It's pretty intense, and they've got testing at the end, and they watch matches, quite complicated matches, and then they have to score the matches, and then they get tested on that. So it's pretty, it's pretty full on.
Yeah.
So what about some of your favorite matches of the night, Thiago?
Can I start?
Yeah.
Okay, my favorite match of the night was definitely Bruno Alves against Marco Souza.
Yeah.
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 For sure.
Yeah. I think that was everybody's favorite. Are you going to get him back for the next one? Maybe just have a super fight?
Yeah, we have to discuss that, don't I? That's not, nothing is right.
Yeah, yeah.
But look, I mean, the goal is if people perform well, they should be rewarded. But that's something we've got to discuss what the super fights available for the next tournament are, because the next tournament's going to be 74 kilos. And we'd obviously have to speak to Marcos as well and see what his availability is. But there's a few things we want to do next time. And, if not the next one, I'd definitely like to see him, because he's just a really good guy too, and really humble, and just he's a great dude, and and he showcased his skills on the other night, so it'd be silly not to at some stage.
I think
one more thing then. For that first show, I would like to thank everyone who was in our fighters who were there and on at BOA, because to convince them to come, we didn't have one show before, and all of them they trust me and they came because they really got what I said, like, oh look, the show will be in this way, like this, like that. Sai is a promoter who promoted more than 8 or 9 Muay Thai shows. I don't know exactly the number, probably 10, Sai.
10 now. Ten
Muay Thai shows, I can say easily. Also, if you go for MMA shows and Muay Thai shows in Melbourne or around Australia, I never seen someone organize Muay Thai shows better than Sai. And I when he invited me to help him on that, I was pretty sure that the BOA was going to be amazing. And I just give that impression to the fighters, and they got that very well. And I think nobody can say the opposite. It was something special in Australian BJJ, and everyone is happy. I think that's what I think.
Yeah, I think everyone I've spoken to, they all enjoyed it. The guys that got to go, the venue was amazing, and they had the drums and everything going, and the fighters all performed really well.
And now about that thing, who we were going to bring or not, everybody wants to fight BOA, man. And I think for the second it will be easier. I have people talking to me all the time, and everybody wants to fight right now. I think it will be easier to do the selection of the fighters on this way. And everybody knows how the show worked first time, and that makes my life easier.
Yeah. Yeah, I think talking about rewarding the fighters that were on the first one, I think Murat's under 74 and a black belt, and actually got a submission win in the first one.
Thiago doesn't want him on again.
What was that?
Sorry?
Thiago doesn't want him on again. He said he's too moody in the lead up.
Yeah.
actually, I didn't like the names, man. Sorry.
Yeah.
You know?
He's just got a bad attitude, He put the guy to sleep. He was celebrating, dancing, nearly fell off the stage. So,
no, look, he's talking
to you. And Lucas is a good guy too.
Lucas is a great fighter. And when I invited Lucas, I knew Lucas was going to fight offensively from the first minute until the last.
Yeah.
I knew that. And I knew that fight could be amazing because Murat does guillotines very well. Also, his jiu-jitsu is amazing, but he's dangerous all the time on the fight. I knew the submission was happening on that fight. I didn't know exactly which side. Of course, as a Murat coach, we made some strategies to make him win, because I saw Lucas fight a couple times and I knew the way he was coming to fight. Little bit, not 100%, but little bit.
Yeah.
And I think our strategy worked perfectly. That's why he was happy, and he respected a lot Lucas, talking serious now. And I think Lucas showed he's a professional fighter as well. And everything happened in the perfectly piece. And I think that's it.
Yeah. Okay. And what about the girls? I know there's two female fights on the night, if I'm correct. How did you think they performed?
What do you think, Sai? So you can start, man.
The female fights, they were great. I mean, the girls started off the night Demi and Chantel. It was exciting. They went for it. It was a close fight. Kane and Olivia was awesome. All I was happy with all the fights. Like, you know, I'm probably not the person that will sit there and watch hours and hours of jiu-jitsu, but I actually enjoyed all the fights that I watched. So,
yeah, I think it was the right length as well, because like I was watching the stream, and yeah, by the time the last fight happened, it was just about right for me. So if it had been any longer, it might have been too much. So I think it was about 3 hours, 3-4 hours. So yeah, no, it worked out.
3.5 hours from start to finish with all the breaks, which was, I think, spot on to keep people engaged.
Yep. Yeah.
Do you know what is funny? Do you know what is funny on that? The level of the fights was so good, so good. People, between one fight and another fight, people didn't go to the bar to buy the drinks, man. They waited all the time for the shows or for the dance or for the drum show. And on that moment, they went to the bar to buy the drinks. And all the moments, they stayed seated and waited the next fight. It was amazing to see that, you know. Everyone was really connected with the show, and they didn't want to lose 1 second of the fights, and that's amazing. It showed how excited the show was from the first minute, and very nice, man. The girls, about the girls, I think Australia has a lot of good girls fighting, and those four girls who represent the female jiu-jitsu in Australia, they did a great show, man. Really, really good show. The first fight, no gi, was really, really close fight, like a submission attempt for both sides. Chantel tried to submit Demi on a kimura from half guard, what was close, but Demi was really brave and she could escape. The same happened with when Demi got a full guard and tried to armbar Chantel, and Chantel could escape and also pass the guard. And in the end, we saw also Demi winning the fight. Chantel finished the fight pressing her, and the fight was just awesome. Until the last second, the score could change, you know. And I think it was a great way to start the show. About Livia and Kate, they are actually, I think they fought a couple times before, and all fights they did was like that, really close, you know, really close fight and really technical from both sides. Yeah. They did very well. Congratulations for all the girls. I'm really happy with the performance of all of them.
Murat, what's it like competing on the first BOA? Talk us through the weigh-ins. Talk us from.
Yeah, I wasn't sure what to expect, to be honest. The weigh-in was. I mean, I haven't really been to many Muay Thai or MMA shows as well. So I've never been to a weigh-in like that. It was very different to a regular jiu-jitsu comp.
Yeah.
Being the day before, just only the athletes that were competing there in a 4-star, 5-star hotel. And then the event was very different as well. You know, we had someone there who was massaging. All the athletes were in the same room. And then, you know, a crowd that's just watching only one match, whereas in a regular jiu-jitsu comp, you have, you know, sometimes 10 mats, okay, you know, 10 fights going at the same time. So no one's really concentrating on you, whereas at this event, you were kind of the main show. So it was very different in that regard. And as a result, I was, to be honest, quite nervous before I went out there.
What's it like when they go, all right, start walking, and you walk down the ramp, everyone's
cheering
your name?
Yeah, no, because I knew pretty much everyone in the crowd, and I had a lot of, you know, friends that were cheering for me. I kind of got a little comfortable once I walked out.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, my adrenaline kind of just took over once I started to fight.
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
About that, also the Sydney fighters, they had a lot of support there. So I can talk about that better, but I think we sold more than 80 tickets for people from Sydney. Is that so?
Yeah, a lot. We had a lot of people, a lot of Sydney people. We had South Australians. But yeah, the Sydney crew was huge. I think Bruno Alves had probably 40, 50 people down there with him. Which you wouldn't be able to hear when the final decision was being discussed, because they were all yelling at the same time.
Oh, yeah, that was a pretty interesting finish to the night. What goes through your head as a promoter? You just sit back and let the referees deal with it?
Yeah, that was the interesting thing. Like, a lot of the people, like, yelling at me. It's like, what are they doing? It's like, well, to me, the people organizing the event, they can't influence the judges in any way. Like, that's just, like, telling me that. I didn't have, like, a favorite or anything. I just wanted the result to be honest and fair. And, you know, the guys judging, they're very experienced guys. They're not going to get swayed because people are yelling at them.
Yeah.
And they basically did the right. It was really interesting because, you know, you've got four, Thiago, all third-degree black belts. And
yeah, all third-degree black belts, man.
And you probably have a couple of white belts and blue belts screaming and abusing him at the same time. And everyone's entitled to their opinion and yelling at me. And I think once it got to about the 8th minute, I turned around to the MC and I said, maybe we should have just stuck to Muay Thai. It was just, I've never had that experience. Like, Muay Thai people complain, but it's over. Whereas he was just going and going. And I thought it was pretty funny. And then when it was decided, I was just kind of relieved to be able to give someone the belt and the money. And, it was nice, but it was a really interesting position to be in.
Yeah, it was pretty. Yeah,
people have to understand. People have to understand. We can't. First of all, it's not fair, and we can't from outside press the referees, especially from the organization, from the direction of the show. We can't give any opinion about the fights to the referees. They have to decide by themselves, because that's how the things has to be, you know. Every single person, also Bruno, in the end of the fight, he looked at me, Thiago, what is going on? I said, don't look to me, man, look to the referees. You stay in your corner, we will stay in his corner, the referees will decide what is happening. And they did that. It's, people think it's just easy to the fighters to fight, but everybody forget about the referees. It's a lot of pressure for them as well, you know. Everybody, Gustavo Mino and Alexander and myself, we didn't want, because I was refereeing 3 fights from the seat. I was one of the 3 referees. Nobody there wanted to make the life of the fighter harder or something like that. We just wanted to do our job. Yeah. The best thing for the referee, start your job, finish the job, and nobody realizes you're there. Do you know what I mean? But sometimes it's impossible to make that happen, you know, and because especially when you have to interpret some things. In the people have different opinion. And we can't make people agree with you, you know, and interpretation is interpretation. And that's it, man. That's it. They did their best and they did well. And I'm very happy with them. That's what I want to say.
Yeah, I think it was a huge step forward for jiu-jitsu in Australia. There's a lot of exposure for individual athletes as well now. You know, it might even lead to things like sponsorship for a lot of these guys who don't really get too much out of the sport. So,
can I just say another thing then? Can I say another thing for you?
Yeah.
Gustavo, I was spoken with Gustavo. Sorry, Gustavo, if you don't like I'm saying that, but Gustavo did the main event of 1FC against Bibiano Fernandez. I don't know if you remember that fight in Philippines.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
He fought against Bibiano Fernandez, and on the venue, they had 17,000 people. All right. 17,000 people watching him, plus the people who was watching him by live stream as well. Gustavo said he felt more stressed to referee BOA than fight on against Bibiano in front of 17,000 people, man.
Yeah.
Or because he knows if he did a mistake on his fight, it's his fight, you know, it's his problem. But nobody wanted to do anything bad to the fighters. That's the most important to know, you know, and... Mm-hmm. The pressure to the referees is huge as well. People sometimes just sit in front of the computer eating popcorn and typing crap things. And
yeah.
That's it, man. That's it. I respect the opinion of the fighters.
Yeah.
I respect the opinion of the referees and the directors of the show. All the other people who are comment about the show, I don't give anything to that opinion, you know, like, because they weren't there, they can't say that about the experience, you know, and that's it.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, cool. All right. Well, yeah, thanks for coming on the show, guys.
Daniel, just before you go, before you touched on the sponsors and stuff, just really wanted to thank all the guys that got on board. Obviously, you yourself and Murad have been really big supporters from day one, but Grant and Scott from the Fight Factory, they've been absolutely amazing guys. The amount of support they've given the show, it's unbelievable. Simon from MA1 provided the mats and prizes for the fighters. Bridge and Royal, the Melbourne Parkview Hotel guys, they put up a few of the fighters. They provided the weighing facilities. They're very close to MSAC, so if you're coming down for the Pan Packs and stuff, hit them up. And Organic Kitchen Caterers. I know it sounds like a bit of a just an extra plug for them, but they did support the show. If you like the show, give back to them. And like I said, the amount of support they gave us for a show that didn't exist, like a couple of the guys I know, and they sort of trust us, but, you know, guys like the Fight Factory, they really went above and beyond. So it was really, really awesome and really overwhelming. So, basically, support them if you like the event, and you know, they're companies that do the right thing, and if you can support them and thank them back that way, that would be awesome.
They're big supporters of our show too, so we always give them.
I have to admit, I was at Fight Factory a few times, and they were actually even more excited than me. They are really big supporters of the show.
And they've introduced me to Piranha and Tactica. I've had so much of that stuff today, I can't stop talking.
And also the staff who helped us at the show, all the guys from Wheeling Street Gym who helped us, and also Nathan Heddle and his team doing the massage and masseuse therapy and helping the athletes who had some problems on the mats, doing the first aid and everything. They worked really well, really appreciate the help. And they did that for the sport. It's really amazing, man, to see what those guys they did on the show. Thank you very much, everybody. Yeah. And thank you very much, Sai, for that great chance to meet you. I learned something new in my life, and I'm really happy, my friend and my boss. Thank you very much.
Stop calling me boss, but thank you very much, Tiago. You got my love.
Yeah, I know.
Guys, is the best man for the job, and you can see the amazing job he did.
Yeah, and I suppose, you know, Sai, coming from a totally different world, it was a pretty big risk financially, and, you know, thanks for putting the show on. I enjoyed the stream. I know we had a few audio problems for the first half an hour or so, but no, the stream was really good. And did you get many people from overseas, or do you have that kind of information that watched the stream?
We will soon. We'll have it soon. And Adam, who did it, he normally does boxing events, and I think he did a really good job for an event he didn't know. Once he sort of realized what he was doing, he went and watched a few different world championships and stuff, and he had that initial issue with the audio, but for a stream to run as well as it did, I was really impressed. I was really, really worried about that, and I think he was really happy about the numbers it did, so I think we got a lot of support. But yeah, look, I was really impressed by the job he did, considering, I mean, at least I've got a fairly okay background with jiu-jitsu and stuff, whereas he didn't even know what jiu-jitsu was until 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, and I've watched some pretty bad streams, mainly ones from like Australia and around Asia, where you get a complete refund at the end of it. So it's good.
Yeah.
Oh, all right. Well, thanks for coming on, and we've got to catch up with Bruno Alves next. So yeah, thanks for your time, guys.
No worries, man. Thank you
very much, Dan. Thank you, Murad. Congratulations, Murad, for your win, man.
Thank you.
We are
all
proud of you. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. I'll see you next time.
See ya.
See ya.
All right, joining us now, we've got Bruno Alves, who is the winner of the BOA Super 8 8-man tournament. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you to invite me.
Yeah.
Welcome, Bruno.
Thank you, man.
So how did you first get involved with the competition?
Thiago, he was planning to do that competition with Sai, and they invited me to compete, you know, like in September, you know, like first of all, I said, man, I cannot compete, you know, like I'm really focused in my school, you know, like I have to make my school grow. All my students, they are like a train really hard, they plan and compete, you know, and even I don't have a lot of training, you know, I train with like a few students, like a high belts, like 1, 2, 3 brown belts, and the rest is just white and blue belts, you know, like I said to him, man, I cannot fight, you know, like I'm probably just gonna fight on the future again. And he said, man, think about 1 week and you let me know again if you want to fight or not. And then I saw the card, I saw the guys that was coming to fight, and I said, man, I should join that. I'm gonna try train as much as I can and do my best there, you know. And that's what happened.
Yeah, we had some pretty big Australian names. We had Marco Souza on the card as well. Do you think there was much exposure over in America or in Brazil? Do you think many people got to watch the event?
I think a lot of people watched the event, you know, like a few friends from Europe, you know, like from America, they was watching live, even Brazil, you know, my coach, you know, a lot of people that I know in Brazil, they was watching as well. I think they comp, it was the first one, but I think that's going to grow a lot. We're going to have like a kind of metamorphosis here in Australia, you know?
Yeah. So what was it like, the venue, like when you first walked out, was it a bit different to your usual jiu-jitsu competition?
Yeah, really different. I was even like a bit like scared at me, or probably gonna, I never get nervous, you know, I'm really calm, you know, like I really concentrate on the comps, you know. And I was thinking, oh, maybe I'm gonna get a bit nervous. No, I never fought in that kind of tournament, you know, like a 300 people watch, you know, just one fight, you know. And but after I saw the venue, you know, I start like just concentrate. I didn't feel any nervous, you know, I feel like any other competition, you know.
Yeah. All right. So you had 3 fights on the night. That's correct.
Yeah. First one was with Kit Dale. The second one was with Marcos Souza, and the final with Will Diaz.
You fought Kit before. What was it like? How did he feel when the match started?
I fought with him like he beat me 2 times, you know, like in last year, you know. One no gi and 1 gi. I lost by points. And was good, you know, fight again, all the time. I was more prepared, you know, I've trained even more, you know, than I trained before. And like that time I knew it would be different, you know, because when I'm trained really well, you know, like I know, like I always fight for the submission. As I try in all fights, if you see all my mats, you know, I always like I try get omoplatas against any other guys, Kit, like against Marco Escape. I try against Will as well. And when I try to do my game, I think it's always hard for anyone, you know, when I fight.
Yeah. I think I noticed you got an omoplata attempt at least on everybody that you fought. They look pretty close. Have you got any questions, Murat?
My question is, how did you prepare, and what did you think of the way the names were pulled out of the box?
Oh man, when they pulled the first name was my name, you know, and I said, man, I hope they pull. I hope they don't pull like the toughest guys on the side. But all guys was tough, you know. Like a man, I couldn't choose anyone, you know. Like, but it was even worse than I was thinking. You know, like me after Kit after Marcos. I said, man, what's going on? Every time that I get like a tougher brackets, you know, I always like I always do well, you know. Like I remember like a Europeans 2011, I just lost on the final to Calazans, but like my bracket was crazy. You know, I fought the first one was with Gabriel Goulart, like a 2 times world champion brown belt, open class. And after I got like Alan Nascimento, Finn Foe, and then after another tough guy, man. Always when I get like a tough bracket, I have a lot of confidence, you know.
Yeah. Because I think, from my opinion, they were the three favorites. I mean, outside of you, you know, you had Kit, Marcos, and Will Diaz, and you beat all of them on the night. So I think he definitely deserved the belt. So
I'm really happy with my performance. You know, like a few things that happened there. You know, like if you see my fights, you know, like a. I tried the submission in every single fight, you know, like I didn't like just on the final, like I was winning by points, you know, like a 9 seconds. Of course, I don't want to try submission, you know, just 9 seconds to win one big comp. You just have to do grips and wait the guy that get double leg and sprawl, you know, and that's what I did on the final, you know.
Well, there's $5,000 on the line. I mean, 9 seconds.
Yeah.
You don't wanna...
people talk too much, you know. Like, I see a few things on Facebook that a bit disappointed, you know, because I came to Australia was to help grow the sport, you know. Like, I was it's not just I could go anywhere around the world, you know. Like, but I choose come here, you know. Like, I'm teach Australians, you know. Like, my main goal is like I have one world champion like in my school, you know, like and people talk about me, say that I am shit, and I'm like, man, please, you know, like see the way that all my fights on the internet, you know, I never did anything wrong. I have the respect of like everyone around the world, you know, the toughest guys, they know me, you know, I train with everyone, I compete against everyone, and I never did anything wrong, you know, and that's let my be disappointed, but everyone have an opinion, you know, they talk whatever they want, especially on Facebook. I want to see them talk on my face, you know.
Yeah. Well, to be honest, like I know a lot of people here and they were quite impressed. I don't know who's saying things on Facebook, but because you hadn't competed for a couple of years, I mean, your name kind of fell off the competitors list, but everyone that I've spoken to here in Melbourne were very impressed. And
I just fought one tournament in Melbourne, you know, like I wanted to fight there, you know, like a lot of people, they didn't know me, you know, like I want to fight this tournament, like because I know how jiu-jitsu is big in Melbourne, you know.
Yep. So just a quick question too. I know you've won a world championship as a brown belt. Have you medaled as a black belt?
Sorry?
Have you medaled as a black belt in the world championships?
Not on the IBJJF, but like we have one federation in Brazil that's called CBJJE. Yeah. I got like a silver medal, you know, like I made the final there against Adriano Silva. And on the World Cup as well is another big comp that we have there in Brazil that they give like a 5,000 reais, you know, like every year, you know, and got second place as well.
All right, cool. And how do you compare this to any of those? I mean, is this one of your biggest victories?
Everyone asked me about my bigger victory, you know, like I won the South America Championship, you know, I got like a few good, like a good titles, you know, but for me, the most important medal was one that I got third place in Abu Dhabi. You know, because like that medal, I had surgery like 3 weeks before the tournament, you know, and no one believed that I could fight, you know, after 3 weeks of surgery, you know, and like I'm as a crazy, I won the trials in Brazil, you know, and I had everything paid to go as we have the trials here in Australia. And I went to the tournament just to like, oh, I'm going to watch, you know, that I cannot fight, you know, that tournament like 3 weeks after the surgery. And then I have a role 1 day before the tournament, you know, my name was there anyway. And I said, man, I'm going to fight that, you know. And then I passed the first match, second match, third match, and I got on the same final. Just watched for Calazans on the same final. I got third place there, you know, in the adults. In Abu Dhabi 2011, you know? That's, for me, is the most important. Gold medal, silver, it's like I could say one gold, you know, but like for me that was once the most important, you know.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah. So who was your hardest fight at the BOA?
The three fights was the hardest one, man. It was crazy, you know, like Keith is crazy, you know. He's a man, he's like an example for any Australian, you know, like you be in Australia and you get the level that Brazilians have, you know, like that's amazing. Like I fought with him, like I knew that I could do anything wrong, you know, and like with him, same thing with Will Diaz, man. Will Diaz is really tough, you know, like I was once the best competitor that I fight, you know, like, and like I was really tough match. And with Marcos on the same fight, man, it was a war, you know, like we didn't stop 1 second, you know, it was like foot locks, you know, I try to get his arm, he threw the legs over, escaped from the omoplata, I try and get sweep, he try to get double leg, it was like a nice match to watch, you know, everyone told him about that.
Well, the promoter said that was the fight of the night, so.
Yeah, man, he went on my foot and my knee was still pain since that day, you know, like because I roll, I roll to the right side, you know, and then I could escape, you know, but it was really tight.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Do you want to talk about, because there's a little bit of confusion with the kit and then there was a bit of confusion with the grand final as well. Because like some people might not know what the points are about for the last match.
Yeah, and like it's easy to have an opinion, you know. Like you see something and you have idea, you know. What's happened there was like I was on my best. Oh, if Keith was, I was on my best submission, you know, the omoplata. Man, when I get that omoplata and I just as I just like man, it's like it's hard. It's really hard to escape, you know. My students, they know about that. They train with me, like once I get that spot and I roll, every time that I roll, become worse, you know, the omoplata starting getting really tight and was really tight, you know. Kit is really tough, you know, because like to hold that two shoulders and he was like a hold, he tried roll. When the referee stopped the match, you know, like was really tight. And then he bring me inside the mat. The referee was on my back. When he let it go, me and Keith, for me, the fight was on. That's why I went direct on the lapel, you know. And you see, I'm going to the lapel, and the referee say, go after, you know. And people started to say that, like, man, he like, he's cheating, you know. Like, he's like, the referee say, go, just after he adjusts the lapel. I went the lapel because, for me, the fight was on. The referee should be on the side of me and Keith all the time. And like, don't let anyone touch anything. And he say, go really close, you know, because I could see, I could hear him. I was just, I was really concentrated on my position. Like when I get the crucifix from the omoplata, it's just like a 2-5 seconds, roll again, it's gone, you know, and I don't think even was the choke. I think was the shoulder more, you know, because like the choke wasn't really tight, you know, it was more the omoplata, I think. I don't know. I spoke with Keith. I sent message for him to say, even when I let it go, the omoplata to celebrate, a few people, even him was talking like that. I kick the pace. No, man, I was like, I unlocked the omoplata and I was, man, really like a, really happy with that moment. I just want to unlock the omoplata and go up to celebrate with my student that was there, you know, like, and what I heard on the internet was, man, that's let me really sad, you know, because like you hear things that, man, everyone in UK, in Europe, you know, I just have a lot of friends, man. I don't have any enemies, you know, like and have here in Australia where I live is really sad, you know, but what I gonna say, you know, like
Well, Kit did come out and he did do a post and said it's not your fault. He blames the referee because the referee should have more control.
I spoke with him enough on the internet today and he said, man, sorry, you know, like I know that things that happen in the moment, we are a bit angry, we don't think about, you know, like but was not my intention, like attack the neck before the referee, you know, it was because like the referee let it go us. I was with like a I couldn't see the referee, I couldn't hear the referee, you know, think about my submission. When he let it go, oh, neck, you know?
Yeah. Wow. Oh, it was a pretty interesting night. And then in the last match, just after the match finished, the referee, he put up the 2 points.
Yeah, 2 points, I don't know. Yeah.
Which changed the score to 5-3.
If I would like to complain, it would be on the beginning of the match, because I got omoplata again on the final. And like me and Will, even Will was helping me come on the middle on the omoplata, you know, and the referee say, come up. I said, man, that's my best submission. When I get the point that I want to submit the person, you say, oh, come up again. I said, no, let's start from here. We are on the middle of the omoplata here. No, come up. We came up and supposed to be like at 2 points, you know, because they said it's 2 points from submission when someone go out, you know. They gave me just 1 point, you know, like 1 point supposed to be if you attack submission and someone escape. What they said, no, I'm going to give advantage. Give 1 point. And they gave 1 point for that omoplata. I lost the omoplata, was 2 points for him. And I had to, like, a fight to get my points again and be on the front, you know. And after the match, you know, like, 9 seconds to the final, like, he tried to get, like, a double leg. I sprawl, and they said that I was run away from the fight, and they gave me, like, a negative advantage. And that negative advantage became 2 points for him that he'll be win. Man, I couldn't accept that, you know, because my bracket was the worst one. I fought as anyone, you know. If you see the match, like, no one deserved that belt more than me, you know. And even, like, outside of the mat, I trained really hard, you know. I trained like a trained as anyone could think about, you know.
Yeah.
I think what happened with why the 2 points got called off was the scorer put an extra penalty.
Yeah.
So you were only supposed to have one penalty. They still penalized you for the last 9 seconds, but that only gave Will an advantage, not the 2 points. And that's why you were still ahead on the points. So that's what happened in the end.
Yeah.
So what are you going to do with the money?
The money, man, the money is like a put on my school, you know. I'm planning to move my school. My school is really small. It's 150 square meters, you know, like crazy people. Like, I need more space. I need, like, buy new mats. I'm going to invest on my school, you know, like, especially I have a lot of talented students, you know. Like, I'm planning, like, make the best team here in Sydney, you know.
Yeah, so your school's the Gracie Baja Crow's Nest. How long's that school been going?
Oh, we are in November. We are open 2 years, you know, like it's 1 year and 8 months, you know. I'm just in Australia, like in November, I'm going to do 2 years that I'm in Australia, you know. I'm not a long time here.
Yeah, and are you available for seminars if anyone wanted to get you down to teach your omoplatas?
Man, I don't think they're going to invite me to seminar. Everyone hates me now. I think.
Man, if they love you or they hate you, they're going to tune in to watch you.
Yeah, they're going to send a bomb for me, you know. But my school is always open, you know. Like, if they want to see if I'm shit or not, if I'm like, I'm praying really bad, man, come and have a roll, you know. It's open, you know, gee, whatever you want to, man.
Man, MMA.
MMA, everything. We train everything there, you know, like
Cool. All right, well, yeah, thanks for coming on and telling us a little bit about the night and about your school and stuff. So yeah, congratulations on the big win too.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the guys, for the boy, you know. Like, I think, man, that's gonna be the biggest event that we're gonna have in Oceania, in like Asia, that side. That's going to be the event, you know. They are doing a great job, was really organized. Everything went really well, you know. Just a few things that, of course, is the first event, you know. They're just going to improve, you know. Every single event, they're just going to improve, and it will be great to be part of that, you know. That's going to be the history of the BJJ.
Yeah. And do you reckon you can make the 74 kilo weight limit for the next one?
I think so. If they invite me, maybe I can drop, you know. Like, I was the last one, just me The Lee thing was light as well, and the Lachlan. I was 82 kilos, you know, with the gi 81.
Yeah, I suppose the weigh-in is the day before, so.
Yeah, maybe I have a try, have a go.
All right. We'll just leave it there. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you. Bruno. Thank you very much, and thank you, Murat, man. Great fight. Great fight there.
Thank you, Bruno. Take care, man. Like I said, I don't think you should stress out, because everyone here is extremely happy with you, and they're quite amazed, to be honest. I mean, you put on a big show, and I think you've at least you can be considered in the top three black belts in Australia now for sure. So,
thank you, man.
All right, thanks. All right, that's it for the interviews for today. I'd just like to thank all our guests who came on the show, and Murat, my co-host. And I would just like to thank our sponsors as well, fightfactory.com.au. BOA was a huge step forward for Australian Jiu-Jitsu, and I think only good things will come. And I'd just like to say I would not like to be a ref under any circumstances. All right, next week we'll be back, and we'll have some more of the competitors from BOA for you guys to listen to.